Good morning. I'd like to start this week with a nice, happy, cheery story, but I can't. I have a very serious question to put to you. That is, can the Bank of British Columbia survive? For the past few days, you have watched the stock go down of the Bank of BC because of negative publicity. Now, the Bank of BC, in case you've forgotten it, is Canada's only Western bank. And, said he editorially, were it to go down, it would shatter considerably the confidence of business and industry in Western Canada. The next question, is the federal government or somebody behind a move to force the Bank of BC to merge with one of the Big Five? Which would make you think, the Big Five don't want any competition. CCB gone, Northland gone, Bank of BC threatened, here is Edgar Kaiser, Chief Executive Officer and Chairman of the Bank of British Columbia. Going to question Mr. Kaiser this morning. On the political side this morning, the straight political side this morning, I've got one of the big guns of the NDP, the most outspoken at times, the most firmly opinionated, little mellower than he used to be, Bob Williams, Vancouver East. We're going to get his kindly view of the state of the province under Premier Bennett in the program. And then, to add more problems to your plate, we have here a spokesman for the BC Teachers Federation, the Teachers Investment Cooperative thing, BCTF, which is down $65 million in its assets, and she wants somebody to guarantee these retired teachers full access to their assets. And she is Alma McGauley from Castlegar. But first, after the break, Edgar Kaiser and the future of the Bank of British Columbia. First, a little background. In the fall of 84, before the CCB and Northland debacles, Edgar Kaiser moved into the Bank of BC, raised new capital, about $160 million, wrote down some bad loans, took over as chairman and put the bank back in business. Then came CCB and Northland, in which $900 million minimum to CCB alone has been kicked in by the Canadian taxpayers to repay the depositors. Last week, a negative report caused the Bank of British Columbia stock to plummet from $4.75 to the $4 and this morning the $3.75 level. My question has got to be very straightforward and blunt. How much of a run has this made on the deposits of the Bank of British Columbia?
Well, surprisingly little, Jack. We've really been once again supported very strongly by the retail customer base we have in Western Canada. Since July 31st of this year, meaning the CCB Northland event, our retail deposit base has grown every month. Now, in fact, you can't say that last week was a good week for us. It wasn't. We did have withdrawal of retail and wholesale deposits based on the CBC story, which, as you know, on Monday night told the nation that our bank was having a deposit runoff. Up until that point, we'd had increasing retail deposits.
How much ran after that story on Thursday night?
Just a very small amount. What happened, it was actually a Monday night story.
Monday night.
And Tuesday, of course, was our biggest day of dealing with the retail run. By Wednesday, it was slowing down, and by Thursday and Friday, stabilizing. So if you take our bank at $3.2 billion in assets, we lost less than $50 million. Western Canadians just have been tremendous in supporting our bank.
You only had a maximum $50 million runoff because of that.
That's right.
All right, now let's get to the... Are you being pressured by the federal government right now to merge with another bank which would leave the
sure.
Big Five in command in Canada? Are you being pressured now?
No, we are not.
Were you being pressured?
No, we have no merger discussions going on.
Were you, in the past tense, pressured last fall when you went to Ottawa and said we want an $800 million added base from the province in deposits, investments, mm-hmm. from the province and from the Bank of Canada?
Well, not from the Bank of Canada. Let me explain that. As you know, banking everywhere is based on confidence. They're fragile institutions. People have to believe in them. And that's true of our bank, too, and true of Western Canada. So what we wanted to do was to be sure we had enough credit, enough liquidity, so that we were not only, as you know, the most conservatively capitalized retail bank in this country today, and that's true this morning as we speak, but we were seen to be ultra-conservative. And for that purpose, we wanted an additional $800 million deposit line from the federal government in the four western provinces. Now,
you asked for it.
That's absolutely right.
You got it.
We did not receive it.
You got it first time round.
We did not receive it. We did not receive that additional security.
You don't want to tell me the negotiating that went on.
Well, no, we just didn't receive it.
You asked for it, but you didn't get it.
That's right. Now, let me go to the second part. At that time and now, we are not being pressured by the federal government to merge with one of the big five. So that's just the way it is. We're not being pressured to merge with one of the big five.
Are you being pressured to merge with anybody?
No. No, we are not.
Were you pressured to merge?
No, we were not.
Did the federal government step in and say, no, we can't give you this $800 million deposit guarantee because we want you to merge?
No, they didn't say that. Now, whether or not they thought it, I don't know, but they certainly didn't say it to me.
Do you feel there's a lack of willingness in the federal government to assist you to give you that $800 million deposit? I'm not trying to destroy your bank or knock it. I'm just trying to lay any blame where possible if we can get a handle on something.
Well, my job
is... Because I believe the Bank of BC should survive.
I know that. I know that. As a customer of our bank and a shareholder of our bank, I know that.
I'm not Lawton Green. I don't get paid for commercials, right?
No, but I'm going to use a plug when I can. Yeah. You bet. No, my job isn't to knock anyone. My job is to do the best I can for the shareholders and the depositors of our bank and the customers of our bank. So, therefore, what I think is important is to know that when the CBC story came out on last Monday night, what we did do is arrange for temporary liquidity lines from the Bank of Canada so that any customer that came into one of our branches could ask for and receive their money. And in fact, it was very interesting as we went through last week, customers would come in and ask for their money. We could say, yes, here it is. And they'd say, that's fine. I don't want to take it. I just wanted to know that I could. So banking is confidence. And I'm not here to condemn the federal government or anyone else. My job is to have for Western Canadians their own bank based here in this province.
Now, what have I learned from you up to now? The CBC story obviously did do a lot of damage.
It did.
No doubt about that.
No question.
Right
about
or wrong,
that.
It did you some damage. So
well,
no
you can't have the nation's television network on prime time on the national news broadcast say that our bank is having a deposit run and have visual imagery of the bank crumbling and not have it affect the
bank.
And
you tell me that run, however, was kept to, amounted to less than $50 million.
Yes, and we can't take the credit for that. That's just the support of our depositors.
But you did go to the Bank of Canada and say, just in case, we want a blank check for liquidity purposes if there is a run.
Absolutely right.
And the Bank of Canada gave you a blank check.
Yes, it did.
And you didn't have a run on deposits.
Well, we did have a run on deposits.
Not beyond the $50 million.
That's right.
And
of the retail deposit base, that's right.
Now, CCB is long gone. Northland is long gone. How long can the Bank of BC suffer even this peripheral nervousness without being forced by the inspectors or the government to merge?
Well, as of this morning, we're fine. I mean, the facts are, and you said, what have you learned this morning? We still are the most conservatively leveraged retail bank in this country. And that happens to be true in North America as well. I mean, that is so. We also don't happen to believe that the West is sinking into the Pacific and that our marketplace is just all dried up the way perhaps Eastern Canada does. And we have seen clear evidence. We have seen clear evidence there is enormous support for our institution in Western Canada, which is our marketplace.
Would it not be good business for the Bank of BC to merge?
Well,
and keep its identity with a bank. Would that not be a good thing as a kind of Pacific Rim bank?
I have to answer that a different way. We have had both acquisition and merger discussions with other financial institutions. Now, you've seen an example of that when we acquired Pioneer Trust. We have had merger discussions with other institutions. The management of this bank runs the bank for its shareholders. If there were a merger discussion, which we believe to be in the best interest of our shareholders, we would recommend it to the shareholders.
Okay.
So far, that has not happened.
And you assure me that the feds have not said merge?
Yes, that's correct. And I can also tell you something else. As a Western Canadian, I would personally like to see our bank independent, based in Western Canada, owned by Western Canadians. But it's not a personal choice. If there is a merger proposition put to us that is in the best interest of our shareholders, whether or not as a Western Canadian I like that, we're going to recommend it to our shareholders.
More with Edgar Kaiser after the break. As you know, Edgar Kaiser, the Bank of British Columbia, the TD was virtually accused of making a run on your depositors. You saw the big ads, didn't you?
I did happen to notice them.
And did you feel that that was aimed particularly at you?
Perhaps we were being paranoid, but I certainly did.
Did they succeed at all in stealing any of your accounts that you know of, in attracting any of their accounts, your accounts that you know of?
No, the numbers show that up until the CBC story, as I've just said, our deposit base was climbing.
Now, we've got to get back to numbers again. The $800 million you asked for investments, that was $200 from BC, $200 feds, and $100 from the Perry provinces.
Well, I'm not confirming those numbers.
You're not confirming those?
No, but the $800 million number is correct, and we asked for that as a deposit line for our bank.
But you're happy, you're confident that you'll maintain your present support without any further draws away from other institutions.
Well, it's clear that we have had. I mean, it's clear that the retail deposit support has returned to the bank as of the end of last week. It's clear that Western Canadians are not stupid. Once the other side of the story, I mean, our suit against the CBC, Jack, is not a defensive suit. I mean, we were shocked. We were shocked by that story.
I don't think we should discuss this particular accusation of damage to you on my particular program. I don't want to be a witness in the case at all.
I think you'd be terrific.
Now, just a moment, please. You yourself have lost on paper well over $2 million in stock value right now, have you not?
Yes, but that's correct, and I don't think I feel any better than any other shareholder does. It doesn't matter how many shares you own, you can't be pleased by an event that had nothing to do with our bank causing the value of your stock to drop.
You have given me assurances, however, that you're getting that you were not blocked by the federal government, to wit, the Tory party, or one of their henchmen.
Blocked in what?
Getting $800 million additional deposit investment.
No, I didn't say that.
No, I'm saying you did not say that.
No, I avoided your question.
You avoided my question.
That's right.
You don't want to discuss that at all.
That's correct.
There are certain areas of political nuances here that you'd rather stay away from.
I'm a banker. I'm not a politician.
Yeah. Well, where do you go from here now? Do you now just sit happily saying, we have fought off a potential run on the bank, therefore we at the Bank of BC have full confidence that we'll keep our commercial and our retail and wholesale accounts and continue on to greater prosperity?
Well, I think happy is a fairly strong word. I mean, I wouldn't have predicted, nor did we enjoy, as you didn't, the events of last week. So what do we do tomorrow? We do tomorrow better than what we did today.
Let me give you a real negative question.
Let me put it differently to you. We're not about to quit. There is a need for, there is a desire for, and there is support for this institution in our marketplace. And as long as that continues, we're going to serve it.
What would happen if you did have a run and had to be, what's the word, went under? How bad a blow would that be to Western Canada?
Well, I happen to think that it is a good thing, not just for Western Canada, but strangely enough for the entire nation, to have financial institutions based other than in the Central or Eastern Canada. I think that's a good thing for our country. That's why I do the job that I do. And that's why I think that the people support us the way they do, and we have had the success that we've had. Now, if you say, what happens if there's a run on the bank? Well, the run on the bank, Obviously, we have liquidity lines from the Bank of Canada, and we've been able to pay everybody their money.
However,
I'm not anticipating a run on our bank.
In other words, it would be disastrous for BC if there were a run on the deposits in the Bank of BC.
Well, you can't say it'd be a good thing for BC.
You are, however, under the, I noticed the Auditor General just the other day gave you a clear bill of health on your loan portfolios, etc. Did he not?
That's correct. There was a special team set up by the Office of the Inspector General of Banks that came in and did a detailed and thorough review of our loan portfolio. In addition to that, as you know, the bank has completed its year end, with obviously this time around the auditors being quite careful in their review, and they indeed approved our financial statements. And as you also know, just last week we announced a 36% increase in our profits of our first quarter versus last year's first quarter.
$1.7 million up over the same period last year or something like that, wasn't it?
Well, the difference was $1.3 million to $1.7 million, or a 36% increase.
Well, what's your next
step? Clearly not a bank going out of business.
What is your next step now, apart from the lawsuit, which will look after itself? Are you going to go back for the $800 million additional investments just to be on the safe side, instead of merely the liquidity promise from the Bank of Canada?
No, in fact, that's what we did. We did it through the Bank of Canada because it was important that we be seen to be very liquid and able to take care of our customers' needs. What we need to do now is to do just what I'm doing with you this morning. In other words, to ask for a continued and increased support of British Columbians in our institution. If you, for example, if you bank with another one of the larger financial institutions, which are good institutions, no reason why you shouldn't do that, but take the extra 10 minutes out of your day and drive two extra blocks, because we don't have as many branches as the other big institutions in this country, but open up an account with us. If you believe there's a need for a Western bank, support it.
All right. Citibank did admit that they had a number of discussions about a merger with you last year, right?
I don't know if you...
Citibank Canada President Robert Burgess said his bank had a number of discussions about a possible merger with the Bank of BC last year. Did you initiate those?
No.
They did?
In fact, yes.
Somebody else did?
No.
They did?
Yeah.
And did you decide, they decided against it because they already bought about 19 other banks throughout the world in the past 3 years?
Ultimately, that's correct.
Now, what about one last negative question to you? The Dominion Bond Rating Service of Toronto downgraded your bank's credit rating a little bit this week, did it not?
Yes.
Have you told them off about it?
Well, we don't think that a bank's rating should be established by press reports.
So therefore, you say the Bank of British Columbia is sound?
Yes, absolutely.
Has got all the liquidity it needs to meet any draw off on deposits?
It appears that not only that, that the deposit draw off has stopped.
And the future looks what?
It looks more difficult this week than it did last week. We can't pretend that last week did not occur. It did. I'm sitting on your show, which normally I wouldn't be doing. We had an event, and that event occurred, and prudent management has to react to the fact it did occur.
You willing to go to some telephone calls?
If you'd like me to, you
bet. See what the public thinks after the break. Keep your calls short and questions if possible. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Jack. Good morning, Mr. Kaiser. In answer to Jack Webster's question, are the other bank ads, drawing any accounts away from the Bank of BC? Your answer was our deposit base was climbing. Now, would you clarify whether individual accounts, corporate accounts, or government accounts? And I'll hang up and listen.
Okay. The answer is that when we were talking about our deposit base growing, as you know, our bank is fundamentally dependent upon retail deposits, not wholesale deposits. And it was our retail deposit base that was and continued to grow throughout the other advertising campaigns.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, good morning, Jack. Mr. Kaiser. 2 years ago, Sports Illustrated did a story on the NFL. I know this sounds a little odd in context of this interview, but I'll tell you what it said. Mr. Kaiser owned the Denver Broncos at the time, and one of the parts of the article concerned what was wrong with the NFL. And they said that one of the problems was carpet-bagging owners like Mr. Kaiser coming into the league, coming in for a fast buck, turning it around and flipping
okay, fair enough question. Well, you were a carpet-bagger down there.
No, as a matter of fact, if the viewer had asked or read an earlier version, they would have said I was a hero because we brought Dan Reeves and John Elway into the Denver Broncos, the quarterback. But the answer was I live here. I live in Canada. And my interests and my family were here, and that's why I sold the team. And by the way, I'm delighted to be running the bank.
Are you a carpetbagger here in the eyes of some of the people in the East?
Well, what do you think?
No, it's not fair to ask me to answer the question.
Well, I don't know. I live here.
Go ahead, please.
Okay, the Bank of BC got rid of its bad loan portfolio by selling it off before you took over the bank, or just right after you took over the bank.
Right.
When you say your bank is the least leveraged bank of the five major banks, is that true? And if that is true, are the other banks out to get you? Are the five other banks unhappy about your situation?
Okay, well, I think there are three questions there. The first is that we did not sell off all of our bad or non-performing loans. We did sell off the majority of the bad or non-performing real estate loans. That's what we did do. We have non-performing loans today as a bank, just as every other bank does. Secondly, in terms of the retail banks in this country, are we the most conservatively leveraged? Yes, we are. In fact, of financial institutions in North America of over $2 billion or more in assets, we are the most conservatively leveraged financial institution. And as to your third question, whether or not the big five have been or are after us, you have to judge that by the marketplace.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, okay, thanks, Jack. I wasn't told I was going to be on
during
that. Anyways, okay, Mr. Kaiser, just keep up the good work. Just keep in there slugging and don't take a back seat to the Eastern boys.
Thank you.
Thank you, and you bet we will.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Jack, Mr. Kaiser.
Good morning.
I'd like to make two quick points and then ask a question. Doesn't this sound a little bit like what Pat McGeer was talking about, Jack? Also, it does sound a little bit familiar, like the old story, the central government ignoring the West. It was liberal, now it's conservative. Also, what about the Hong Kong money, the Pacific Rim investing in BC? I'll hang up and wait for your answer.
You can't handle a political one, but what about the Hong Kong Bank?
Well, as you may know, Jack, we have a very active Chinatown branch, and we also have a branch in Hong Kong as well. And both of those branches are doing very well. There's no question that the trade and commerce which exist between our province and the Pacific Rim is there today and will continue to increase, and we hope to participate in it.
Go ahead from Kamloops.
Yes, good morning, Jack. Mr. Kaiser. I'd just like to say we've been customers for 7-8 years now, and we will continue to be so, and we're very pleased with your bank.
Thank you very much.
Go ahead, please.
Jack.
Yep.
I just want to tell him that we're with him all the way. We need a Western bank. We need this one. I'm a yuppie, and I'm involved in marketing. My next comment is a question. What is your marketing strategy as far as... depositors like Jack?
Marketing strategy. She wants a loan from him.
No, she asked in terms of depositors. And I, what we would love to see happen is people that may or may not bank with us today, we may not be there convenient to them, to show their support by opening an account with our bank, that it's important to them whether or not they use our services on a daily basis. It's important to them to have a Western bank based here.
Go ahead from Campbell River.
Thank you, Jack. It's been a while since I got through. I was delegate to a private enterprise political party who elected the leader who is interested in Pacific Rim trade, and incidentally, he's Canadian born.
No, I don't want that.
They want to know what influence the Bank of BC and or Mr. Wilson's proposed international banking centers in, I think, Montreal and
Vancouver. Good question. What is this international banking center? Is that any good to anybody?
Well, one thing that has been true of all financial centers has been that they all have a number of characteristics, but there is only one characteristic that is common to all banking centers, and that is that they have a major financial institution headquartered there. That's true of every financial center that exists in the world. So There is no doubt that that if we can make Vancouver a international finance center, it's a good thing for our province. But we've got to have a bank based here to cause that to be a reality.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Kaiser. Mr. Kaiser?
Yep.
Yes?
You're a Canadian now, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Well, I think that should be made right off the bat. Jack should have mentioned that they're not, there's not two imports there, one legal and one illegal. I think that's important, and I think the bank is doing a hell of a good job, in my experience.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be a Canadian.
Go ahead, please.
Mr. Kaiser, is it not correct that a non-performing loan would affect the liquidity position of the banks?
Yes, it affects your earnings and not the liquidity position so much as the fact that if you've lent X amount of money to an individual or a corporation and you're not being repaid for that, you have to carry the cost of that.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, good morning, Jack and Mr. Kaiser. I used to belong to the Green Machine when I lived in Alberta, and I was depositing there and making payments up to $400 a month.
What's your
for
question?
4 years, and I moved down to BC, and I wanted to borrow $500 to get insurance for my van and establish a credit with a bank at Toronto Dominion down here, and they wouldn't do it. And I phoned the Bank of BC, and I talked to this nice lady there, and she had me set up with an overdraft account and all set to go that afternoon.
Good. Nice lady set them up at the Bank of BC.
That's important, Jack.
Well, fair enough. I'm stressing it. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Jack, and good morning, Mr. Kaiser. What I would like to know is what facts prompted the journal to report that there was a run on your bank? So irresponsible, you know, in a journalistic way, to have reported it without some kind of, question mark there.
I wish I were free, just as a human being, to comment on your remarks. But because we are in litigation, I'm unable to do that.
I think that's a smart answer. Go ahead, please.
Yes, am I on now?
Yes.
Good morning, Jack and Mr. Kaiser.
Good morning.
I came up from the United States and started a business about a half a block away from the bank in Burnaby, and was told by the manager when I asked for a line of credit that your bank was not interested in small business loans.
Well, there's a negative one to polish off before you go.
Well, I can't speak to the individual account, but in that case, we must not have been.
Yeah, and therefore that's perhaps something you have since corrected. Well, just to let you go for the moment, when will the next headline break in the Bank of BC?
I really can't answer that. You might know better than I would.
No doubt about it, the Bank of British Columbia has been under some forms of attack, and developments will occur from day to day, but you're telling me you're fully confident in the base in the bank, you've covered your liquidity, people should still have full confidence in the Bank of British Columbia.
Well, I still have all of my deposits and my shares in the bank, Jack.
Because you're down to, what, $2.5 million on paper at the moment yourself, personally.
That's so?
That's correct, isn't it?
Yes.
From $6 to $3.75, and you put in $6 million worth of shares.
No more than that, actually.
$8 million?
Yes.
You're down quite a chunk. Well, wish you all the best, Edgar Kaiser, President of the Bank of BC. And next, we'll go to another political interview, this time with Bob Williams of the NDP. Bob Williams was the Minister of Forests in that celebrated NDP government in 1972-1975. As a matter of fact, industry people will still tell you, and I'm not paid to say this, that he was one of the best forest ministers that BC ever had. Always surprised me because they were terrified when he went into power. He was out of public life for about 9 years. Now he's back, of course, Vancouver East NDP. We haven't been in touch much, but
no.
Let your hair down if you'll forgive the crack.
Who, me?
Yeah. What about an election? What's your professional opinion as to the possibility of an election between now and the spring of next year?
Oh, I think there's every likelihood, Jack. What's on the drawing boards for next year in British Columbia? Nothing. There's nothing on the drawing boards. Everything is focused on Expo and a couple of other projects. So clearly everything is designed to an election this year.
Would it make any sense for them to call a house, drop a writ, go on special warrants and have an election before Expo? I mean, your opinion of it, not his.
Yeah. if he sees the numbers and thinks he's on an up with all of the hype for Expo, there's a slim possibility of that, sure. And he could deliver us a phony budget, as he's done before, and then we could get restrained afterwards, as he did before as well. So that's a possibility.
But what you're telling me is a cynical, clinical analysis. The premiers, whether it's the NDP or the Social Credit or Mulroney, they go when the polls tell them to go.
Sure. Once they're satisfied, they've bottomed out and it's pulling up. And we've got a particularly tough problem in BC. We have a tight election period, only 28 days, toughest in all the country. And so you can manipulate public opinion to a greater degree in a short period like that.
Do you happen to know what your polls or his polls say at the moment?
I guess they say that he shouldn't go at the moment, otherwise I think he would have gone.
He would have gone by now. Yeah. All right, now let's look at the possibility of a budget. If they call the House, they're calling the House on the 10th, I think it is, he can bring in a budget and wrap up the session by the end of March, can't he?
Oh, easily, yes.
What do you anticipate will be in the budget? Have you given it any thought at all? I know there's going to be a $1 billion deficit to start with.
Well, in times like this, I think we should have a deficit. You know, times are tough and the extra money should be found to create jobs and the rest. You know, he's not very good at that. He spends a lot of money and doesn't create a lot of jobs.
I think there's a case for the Coca-Cola,
oh,
surely.
Come on, Jack. They spend half of every day digging through snow and ice to start building on the road for the rest of the half day. That's going right now in British Columbia because he's got an election time schedule. Now, is it very productive to spend half of every working day digging snow and ice? I don't think so. No. And yet that's what's going on in British Columbia today. They claim to be good business managers, but they're anything but.
ALRT is a delight and a joy to most people in the Lower Mainland. Surely that was one of the really good things that they have done in the final analysis.
Well, there's no question we needed a rapid transit system, Jack, but it probably cost us four times what an alternative system would have cost. The debt is building up. It's going to be a 30-year debt. There'll be no payment on the principal until the 13th year under Gracie's scheme. So it's a ballooning debt problem as well.
Now, Expo itself, where the devil would we have been in this time of recession, which it is, without the spent, how much already, $500 or $600 million on Expo right now, where would we have been without that integral development in downtown Vancouver for the year of 86? Well, and 85, well, and 84.
Well, that's true. It's certainly creating some jobs, but, you know, they're putting those buildings all up and then they'll be knocking them down. It's better than just digging snow and ice, but one could have had longer-term projects, but we all want it to succeed and we're all going to support it. I think it could have been a little more exciting, could have had the best brains in the province involved in it, could have had people like Arthur Erickson designing buildings, but he was blacklisted because he once supported the NDP. Could have had Davis Suzuki doing film for it, but he was blacklisted because he once supported the NDP. So there's a mean-mindedness around that and other projects that hurts them and British Columbia, I'm afraid.
What's your biggest single complaint about the use of our resources in British Columbia? Which development, which mega project irks you the most?
Well, I think Bill Bennett's biggest projects, the two really, have been brick and Northeast Coal, and both have been monumental failures. A so-called businessman's government, you know, the market is telling us that brick is worth a quarter of what it was supposed to be worth originally. Northeast Coal, basically a $3 billion project, and write-offs galore there. So his biggest projects have not worked out. And he's tended to ignore our most important industry, the forests.
Well,
it's a double-edged problem.
That's where you were the minister for 3 years or so, 3 or 4 years. But the fact remains is you cannot blame social credit, or even the industry for that matter, for the collapse of many of our world markets, can you?
No, we've had good markets actually in recent years in lumber. Our level of production in terms of volume of lumber is as high as any time in our history. The problem is that we haven't kept up technologically. The government has seen it as a sunset industry and has chased will-o'-the-wisp stuff like Expo, if you will, instead of rebuilding the industry. We're now about a generation and a half behind the Scandinavians in our forest industry. We are the highest cost producer of pulp and paper now in the world, with probably some of the best timber. That tells you volumes about the government and the industry, and the fact that Bill Bennett doesn't really do his homework.
Well, the fact is, of course, that the taxation load in the pulp industry and every other industry has been brought about because of the lack of other revenues.
No, that's not so. the we supply wood to the pulp and paper industry at the lowest cost in the world. The lowest cost in the world, and they are the highest cost producers in the world. We have terrible structural problems, terrible problems of not keeping up in terms of technology and excessive management costs. We are unequal in the world because nobody's doing their homework in Victoria, and the boys in the industry are too engineering oriented instead of being market oriented.
And the highest wages in the world too.
Oh, but the problem is that we've got technology that's 1960. All our pulp mills are belchers like Harmac that H.R. McMillan himself brought in. We're 20 years behind in terms of technology. And if we had the technology, our labor costs would be lower because the unit costs would be lower.
So you say that they're disastrous because they don't plan and they don't lean on industry to be up to date.
I don't think anybody's working in Victoria. I don't think anybody's home. I don't think anybody's managing the ship. I think Bill Bennett spends too much time in Palm Springs and not enough time working late in his office to get the economy on track.
Now, what about Indian land claims and TFL 24? The Charlottes, what about that? Is everybody crazy?
What do you mean, is everybody crazy, Jack? I mean, you mean if they don't believe, if they don't agree with you, they're crazy? Is that what you're saying? You're sounding like Pat McGeer. Come on.
Bunkum, bunkum, bunkum. No, the fact is, though, that any reasonably sane person can say there's got to be room for both.
Yes.
In British Columbia.
Yes.
You've got to keep your national heritage regardless of land claims.
But do you know how much waste is going on in the Queen Charlotte Islands right now with the logging that's going on there now? It's high grading on a scale never seen before in British Columbia's history.
Clear cut most of it.
Oh yeah, but they're leaving half of it behind. Half the timber gets left behind. Fallers there were getting checked by McMillan Bodell because they were unhappy with their productivity. And then when they checked it out, they realized that half the trees were being left behind in the woods. Only the very best were being taken out. So, you know, we can have
parks. Who's to blame for this?
Well, the government is to blame. They're the managers of the public land. But we can have parks and logging, too, if we eliminate the waste in British Columbia.
How many years will it take us, therefore, to bring ourselves up to date and eliminate the waste?
Oh, it'll take a while, and it'll take a change of government.
Well, a change of government to a government that knows what it's doing.
I agree.
And who knows if that's the NDP or not?
Well, I guess that remains to be seen, but I think
it's
pretty
clear. But I mean, from the point of view of an ordinary person, when we have jobs that can be fulfilled right now by logging, surely to goodness we got to do them. We can't
exactly
cut down jobs because of somebody's...
But if we leave half of every tree in the woods, think of the jobs and waste that that represents.
But why do
Nowhere else in the world would that be done. We're doing it now because these companies are so over-leveraged, they're paying their bank debts with exporting raw logs, and the government is turning a blind eye and letting it happen. We are gutting our forests now to pay bankers and debts that the bank should probably rightly take a bath on. There are a lot of bad loans out there in British Columbia, bad loans that should be written off. But in fact, they're not being written off. The loans are not being reduced. The government is letting logs be exported to pay the bankers. Now, that doesn't really help
what
the people of British Columbia.
What you're telling me is that because of the operation of the Vancouver log market...
The export market.
Yeah. Well, it all goes into the Vancouver log market, doesn't it?
That's part of the game they play, yes.
So are you telling me that the prime logs are going for export and the lesser logs are going to Vancouver log market?
Yes.
Where doubtless they are bid up by the big boys to make it difficult for the little boys.
Well, it isn't a free market, Jack, so there's a lot of complications along the way. But the basics are that the companies are exporting the best logs from British Columbia to pay their bank debts that probably should be written down.
I've had that said, too, but I can't find any way to prove it.
Well, you know, if the banks are already sitting on the boards of directors of some of these companies, as they are with
surely the goodness the Forest Department could make sure that our best logs are not exported.
Of course they could.
And that our mediocre logs should be exported.
Exactly. And our best logs should be used for value-added products like the Scandinavians. They get four times the wealth out of their forests compared to ours. Just think, if we doubled the wealth out of our forests, we would have nobody unemployed in British Columbia. If we came close to meeting the standards of the Scandinavians, we would be employing everybody in the province.
But you can't do that overnight, even if you were in power.
Can't do it overnight.
In 20 years.
But Bill Bennett's had 10 years, and it's been a downhill slide every one of those 10 years. 6,000 people voted with their feet this last year in British Columbia. For the first time in modern history, they walked out of British Columbia to find jobs in Ontario.
They had to.
Exactly.
More with Bob Williams and your calls, too, after the break.
¶¶ Say a few words, Jim.
Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The rain in Spain. Good morning. Some of the subjects we'll be dealing with at noon today. The ideal employee. Who's the corporate star? Chances are the corporate star these days is the fellow who was kind of the misfit 15 or 20 years ago. Maid service. Should you get the regular cleaning lady, or should you call in one of these firms that blitzes the house in 2 hours? Pixie children. This is a syndrome that would appear to be rare, but whose incidence is doubling. Children look like little elves. It's details at noon.
But we won't let new entries into the system.
No.
If we did.
Have you met Jimmy?
Oh, yeah.
Well, certainly, I suppose the NDP has deserved its 11 years in the wilderness, and you don't look very strong for the next election, although you're getting rid of a number of your old fogies, aren't you?
Well,
except for yourself.
I mean, I'm younger than I look, Jack.
McDonald won't run again.
That's right. We have young Glenn Clark, a 27-year-old candidate with a master's degree, very bright, and a lot of people like that coming along. The mayor is coming on board, Mayor Mike, so it's quite encouraging. We've got the editor of the Salmon Arm newspaper running up there, and a lot of good people around the province.
Mike, he's quite prepared to be a backbencher after Bennett wins the election. It's amazing. Go ahead to Bob Williams.
Hey, good morning, Jack. Mr. Williams.
Yes.
I'd like, Mr. Williams, perhaps maybe you can clue Jack in also, as seeing how the business community won't do it, about the $20 billion debt this province has accrued over the last 10 years. And the brick one, I think, is indicative of exactly the type of money management that's been going on in the last 10 years in this province. Mr. Webster and this local media around this town perhaps should do a little research when they start talking about this province and the mega project mentality that's been going on around here for 10 years. I think Mr. Webster's turned into more of an entertainer than a journalist.
It's shame on you, John. Shame on you. You're entertaining.
I
saw you singing with Katie Lang. You can't deny it.
And you would have...
We brought Katie Lang here first.
Did you?
She's a wonderful person.
Who's we?
Well, in one of our entertainment spots that we're involved in. But I'll make plugs.
Are you in the nightclub?
You got it, yeah.
And you're in the credit union business?
Yes.
Yeah, yes. Hardly the old state socialist
there
you were 20 years
there
ago,
you
are.
You got to see, as the man said, you got to adjust your thinking, Jack.
Go ahead, please.
Hi, Mr. Williams. I'd like to ask you about alternatives in the upcoming provincial election. Obviously, you feel that the NDP is viable. However, I think from a public image standpoint, the NDP doesn't do enough to really bring themselves out to the public.
Well, I agree. People like Jack here don't like us on board here often enough. But
nonsense.
We'll do our best.
Do the best we can.
But then they bring on people like McGeer, and that helps us anyway.
Sure. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I'd like Mr. Williams to speak to Bill M-225 on the Jobs First Employment Strategy.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's a private member bill from Bob Skelly, so I guess the lady has received that from Bob Skelly. It's basically a 60,000 job creation proposal that the NDP has, a Jobs First strategy, which would involve helping the municipalities build up their infrastructures and the rest. So it's a 60,000 job program.
Tell me, as a free enterpriser, which you are, an entrepreneur, which you are.
Yes, I've been all those things.
Do you not have some sympathy with the construction labor relations people who say, we can't afford $23 to $30 an hour, including fringes? You got to come down to $18 to $20. Is that not reasonable on the part of that employer?
I don't think I'd really want to get into the details of that argument, other than to say that historically, I don't think enough of us have realized that the economic push in North America in the post-Second War period has essentially been a wage-driven economic boom since the Second World War. So by and large, I'm saying better wages has built a better economy, forced management to be more efficient, and companies to be more efficient. If you're paying more wages, it pushes you into efficiency. And I don't think we think about that enough, Jack.
I grant you that, but I can give you a specific on the Coca-Cola.
Yes.
Where you have Kirchhoff, the non-union contractor,
and
you've got a good union contractor with a long history.
Yes.
Cost them nearly $1 million additional on the contract to meet the fringes for the Building Trades Councils in accommodation in Chilliwack, travel time to the job, travel time back to the accommodation and all the fringes. $1 million it cost them more bidding at the lowest to meet the terms of the contract. Mm-hmm. Now that becomes intolerant, whereas Kirchhoff can say, bring up your mobile home and park on the site and it's at your own expense.
Well, it becomes an impossible market pressure, all right. There's no doubt about that.
So what does the unionized worker do? He doesn't get jobs, so he goes to work for Kirchhoff anyway.
Yes, I know that's happening. Yeah.
And there's no escape, is there, at the moment?
At the moment, there isn't, no.
But let's add the other segment of the lecture. They were the ones, the contractors, who would turn around every year and say, here's another couple of bugs, we can pass it on to the customer.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, we have a range of industries where it's been a pass-through situation, all right. That's right.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Mr. Webster. Good morning, Mr. Williams.
Good morning.
Mr. Williams, you compromised your credibility with the cheap shot that you gave about the premier being in Palm Springs. Could you give us the number of times he's been there and how long? I'll hang up and listen.
I'm just saying that the very fact that the premier likes to keep it quiet when he's there, that reporters have a hard time finding out where he is holidaying and so on, begs the question. And I think that there's enough evidence around that he's not at home doing the job. The economy of British Columbia need not be like the economy of New Brunswick. Our assets far exceed the Maritimes, and yet all of the numbers put us into the basement league, and that's unheard of in the modern era. And I think Bill Bennett has to take a lot of the blame for that.
Go ahead from Revelstoke.
Good morning, Jack. Mr. Williams.
Good morning.
Covered a lot of points there, but I would like to make two specific points. One, as Mr. Williams said, we're shipping record volumes of wood out of British Columbia right now, so doubling our production isn't going to help in a market that's got an oversupply situation. And number two, I do wish Mr. Williams would go easy with his criticism of Northeast Coal, because I think he knows that the official announcement of the support by the government of BC for Northeast Coal was made by Gary Locke in an NDP government.
I think the project that Mr. Locke was working on was Secunca Coal, which involved British Petroleum's. That project was not pursued, as in so many other cases where the NDP government initiated something, Mr. Bennett wouldn't touch it simply because it was initiated by the NDP.
No, instead, we're talking specifically about the Teck and the Bull Moose mines.
No, I think
so. If you check the Victoria Columnist December the 7th, I think you'll find that Gary Locke made the official announcement.
Okay, we'll leave that
public support
unsettled for the moment. I want to ask you about Site C.
Mm-hmm.
Should we be building Site C to export power for cash to California?
Right now, we export power to British Columbia, and it's from Revelstoke Dam. Revelstoke Dam cost us 35 mils. We've been selling on the spot market for 12 or 14 mils. That is, we're selling at less than half the cost of production.
You mean to Washington State?
Through Bonneville.
To the intertie.
Yes. So, you know, it doesn't make any sense. Nobody can stay in business if they sell their product at half the cost of production. And that's what they're doing. So what it really means is that the people of British Columbia pay the high rates, and our cheap dams of the past, in fact, are the power that's exported to California.
I want to get that right. You say 35 mils is the cost of production at Revelstoke.
Yes, yes.
We're selling surplus power from the systems.
Yes.
At 12 mils, which is a third of that.
That's right. On the spot market, it fluctuates.
And you're saying, therefore, ipso facto, that it would be impossible to build and supply power from a new dam at the full recovery of the capital cost.
Exactly. Exactly. And one would have to insist on that. Now, in Manitoba, they've been smart enough to say, we will sell at the cost of production in the United States, far more beyond their own costs of production, and then tie it down with a firm contract. We've never done that here.
One more short segment with Bob Williams, the NDP Vancouverist. Hey, how old are you now, Bob?
53, Jack.
Don't look a day more.
Thanks, it stops.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning. Mr. Williams and
good morning,
Webster. I'd just like to talk to you a little bit about this export, Woody.
Okay.
It happens to be that I'm a local logger, and bucking is my trade.
Mm-hmm.
As much as I'm against the export of raw logs to Japan, Korea, and China, it happens to be the one thing that keeps me and a lot of the boys I work with into the work. It's almost, you'd have to describe it as a crime to see a 45 or a 50 foot log come down to a dry sort and end up being bucked anywhere from 15 feet to whatever length off of the, that piece
exactly.
of wood. Anything underneath 12 feet goes for firewood.
I mean, they do it deliberately?
Yes,
yeah.
sir.
No, the buyers are insisting on the best quality.
I've been doing it for years. 40 feet is the maximum for shipping. 22 is the minimum for shipping. So if we get a log that's, say, 40 feet long and 18 feet of it isn't up to spec for shipping, we'll buck that 18 feet off. And lucky for that, you know, lucky for the local guys, they'll get 18 feet of what is still,
exactly.
we would class prime piece of woody, whereas anything under 12 feet is garbage.
That's exactly it. You know, that's what's happening in British Columbia right now.
Just explain that to me again, Bob.
They're just taking out the best piece of the log and junking the rest. That's the problem. So the big.
I don't know. You know how you define junking it.
Well.
But like a lot of the, I'm having problems talking to you here. A lot of the pieces that we consider A number one for the local market are nowhere near the standards that are getting shipped out of the province.
Oh, I get the point. In other words, the good stuff's going to export and the shot junky pieces are going for local.
Yes, sir. And a lot of it, I've been, like I said, I've worked in all aspects
okay,
of,
I've got
the,
your message.
Of the export and the...
But I think that you'll agree, Bob, that to get to the nub or the bottom of the rights or wrongs of these things is damn nearly impossible. If your system in the mills and the logging camps and in the scaling isn't working properly.
Well, that's right. And we have problems across the board in terms of scaling and in terms of waste. I'm advised that if they were properly billed for the waste in the Queen Charlottes right now, it would exceed what they pay in stumpage.
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yep.
Yeah, I've got a comment. That is, one thing I find about Mr. Williams, good morning, Mr. Williams.
Good morning.
That the NDP is so negative on everything. It doesn't matter what it is. Now, I can't understand how a government could be in so long, the government of today, and do everything wrong all
mm-hmm.
the time.
Mm-hmm.
Either all of us BCites are out of step and you're in step, or there's something wrong. You ever think of anything about that?
Well, yeah.
I'll hang up and listen.
I think that British Columbia is one of the provinces of Canada that can be almost anything it wants to be. Yet in the last decade, it's been a downhill slide. You know, the biggest projects of the Bennett era have been failures. You know, has brick been a success? I think not. Has Northeast Coal been a success? I think not. Well, we're in the opposition. I think we need to bring that back because you don't hear Bill Bennett talking about brick. You don't hear him talking about Northeast Coal. But the other side of the coin, you're right. We can be anything we want almost in British Columbia. This province can be turned around. The problem is partly in Victoria. That's what has to be dealt with.
But when I hear people like Mulroney boast that, or Wilson, that they made 558,000 jobs in Canada since they came into power, I don't believe a word of it. Now, why don't I believe a word of it?
Because you're looking at British Columbia, and the bulk of the jobs are elsewhere, Jack,
51,
not in British Columbia.
They say 51, 54,000 jobs in BC. What kind of jobs? What are they?
But we're just not keeping up. We've actually been slipping behind.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Mr. Williams, and
good morning,
Jack. I agree with you, Mr. Williams. I'm 63 years of age right now, and my husband retired 18 months due to unemployment before he had to. He was in construction union, electrician.
Mm-hmm.
Now, regarding jobs that Bennett ran his platform on, you know, it's been a bloody disaster. And there's a lot of women like myself who's healthy, who could have been working, you know, right up to the age of 65. But he's creamed this province. He's got no interest in this province at all. And all he's thinking of is the fast buck. And then he's going to leave people like my husband and myself who are going into retirement, you know, hard up.
I know.
Well, there's a whole range of things that could have been done beyond. That is job sharing and early retirement and that sort of thing. But that's not the kind of thing Mr. Webster would like to discuss today, I don't think. Early retirement and job sharing.
As a matter of fact, if the Charter of Rights wipes out mandatory retirement at 65, I think that'll be damnable. I want to see mandatory retirement at 65.
What are you? You're saying that and sitting here and collecting your old age pension, Jack. Come on now.
And my CPP. And I'm
right.
prepared to retire as soon as I can find someone to take my place.
Okay.
But anyway, I'll see you on the hustings.
Fair enough. Thanks.
It'll be within a year.
It'll be shorter than that.
Not during the expo.
Not likely.
You pick October.
I guess the end or the slim chance of earlier. Yes.
Good. My thanks to Bob Williams, Vancouver NDP East. NDP Vancouver East. Next, we're going to talk to Al McGauley about the problems with the Teachers Investment Cooperative. After break. Alma McGauley is a retired teacher from Castlegar, right?
That's right, Jack.
And she's here to tell us of the situation as of today in the insolvency, I think is the right word, of the Teachers Investment and Housing Cooperative, where the money is frozen and where nobody can get at their investments, and where the complaint is that the government, says Alma, should do something to hold an inquiry into the co-op failure and make it possible for the deposits of the retired teachers and all everybody else to be guaranteed. Is that correct?
Yes, that's right. And essentially, we would only be asking for the inquiry after the restructuring proposal is put to us. And it's not 100% true to say that we can't get any money. Those people who can't get any money are like myself, and they have their total savings in registered retirement savings, which we thought was a magic entity. And the people who have money in regular term or in bonus accounts or whatever, they can get, in fact, 0.5% per month.
Do you mean to tell me that your $70,000 you're talking about is tied up into an RRSP in this investment co-op?
It's all in RRSPs that I bought at different times. Some are in term deposit RRSPs, but it's all in RRSPs, yes.
And because they're in RRSPs, of course, you can't have access to them at all.
But that is not the information we were given. In December, I phoned the co-op from Castlegar, and they told me that they would be rolling 0.5% of what we had per month into new RRSPs, which then, of course, were not frozen and could be deregistered as I pleased. But my husband and I went there the other day and found out that we cannot withdraw any money.
Now, in November last year, all the assets were frozen because the place was insolvent, because I suppose the real estate loan potential market value didn't match the outstanding amounts.
That's exactly it. And there's a $65 million shortfall, and that is what we are asking the government of BC to guarantee on the basis that under the Cooperatives Association Act of British Columbia, they have someone called a superintendent of co-ops whose duty and
function
and has the authority to regulate the co-op. We say he did not do his job. We say it could have been done in one of two ways. They could have alerted us to the fact that our deposits were in fact not insured. When the story first broke, I thought I had slightly under 60, and I thought I was okay because I assumed deposit insurance.
You thought it was a, quote, a bank.
Right. And the idea that it was a bank, the mistaken perception that it was a bank grew from its beginnings in the 51, and that cooperative was organized to help teachers with obtaining mortgage funds, because the banks at that time, as you probably know, didn't lend people like us money unless we didn't need it.
So therefore the Teachers Investment and Housing Co-op was set up for an investment fund and for the loaning of mortgages to the people who had put money into the investment fund by and large.
Well, it wasn't an investment fund in the beginning. It was simply a housing co-op set up to give our fellow teachers money and to mortgage their, to buy houses,
and
to provide mortgage
money.
While
it's clear that you're not a bank like any other bank which would have CDIC, you feel that the superintendent of co-ops was responsible for not warning or supervising this change in the asset figures, which gives you the $64 million deficit.
Well, I not only feel that, I feel that the Cooperatives Act of BC cites that.
Does it? You got
yes.
it there?
Yes, I have it here. Under duties of superintendent, it says, it is the duty of the superintendent to A, examine the memorandum rules of all proposed associations desiring to be incorporated under this act, inquire into the conditions on which they will operate, and the most significant one, D, exercise the powers and duties conferred on him under this act in a manner to facilitate the carrying on of enterprises as to organization, operation, and administration on a cooperative basis, at the same time protecting the public interest. We say the public interest was not protected.
And you can point to the fact that co-op deposits and credit unions are guaranteed 100% by the provincial government.
Exactly. But somehow our organization slipped through the cracks. It neither fits under bank, trust company, or credit union, so it's not guaranteed by either federal or provincial.
Yeah, I suppose we should point out, though, that if the real estate market were to recover and the valuations of the mortgage properties went up, you would be technically solvent again, wouldn't you?
But we wouldn't be happy still. We have received a lot of education in the last 4 months, and it's been received with great anxiety. We now know that we must have deposit insurance. And even deposit insurance will not solve our problem, because contrary to what Mr. Veach said on CBC Radio the other day after my little
outburst,
he said that we were greedy investors, number one, and he said that we're small investors. Most of these letters from over 100 people have in excess of 100,000.
I should say
60,000, many being over 100, but most have in excess of 60. And some who have only 10 to 20,000 tell me it is all their savings. Now, the people that are hardest hit, this is a letter from a man who's 86 years old, his wife is 82, and he has 60,000 in there. Remember that anyone who taught that long ago, it was only in 1972 that pensions were improved, and so he has a very small pension, and he says that his wife is blind. They counted on that interest payment every month for their necessities. We have also other stories of people telling us they can hardly put bread on the table because they can't have access to their money. Now, he says, I think, very, very mildly, so it has left us very short since then. A beautiful person, I'm sure, an old man whose letter is very...
Furthermore, all the funds are now frozen, and even if he wanted his little bit of money out, over 60,000, my goodness, he can't get any of it.
So you see, really, Jack, what's happened to us people who grew up during the Depression, really wanted badly to... Provide for our own retirement, provide for our security for our old age, did not want to be beholden to family or state, have had the cushion of our security just pulled out from under us. And not much
sympathy from the government, because one, you're not a bank, you're not a credit union, you're not a deposit insurance. They can say to you, you made a bad investment.
That's right. But you have to understand why we invested. We really didn't invest. I myself was not even aware that I was investing. I heard the word savings. Registered retirement savings. Also, it was, when I started investing, called BCTF retirement savings, and I put a lot of stock on the fact that it was my professional
organization.
Where
do the teachers' union stand now?
The teachers' federation, and I'm glad that you brought that up because you introduced us incorrectly. I do not represent the BCTF in any way. I am an honorary member of the BCTF, but in essence, they have deserted me and all my colleagues who are in this sad situation. But the Retired Teachers Association has come along on my campaign with me, and I really appreciate their support because it gives us an organizational basis. And under their letterhead, we have requested a meeting with Premier Bennett for March 21st or at his earliest convenience. What we are seeking from the government is certainly not a bailout. It is simply a guarantee. People do not understand the word guarantee. What it is purely a co-signing. It would not necessarily involve the expenditure of a cent, because there are those real estate properties in Edmonton, in Calgary, in Vancouver, that if the market shows the resurgence it has in the East already, will appreciate over a number of years. And we say that the government is going to lose a lot of money if they don't support this guarantee. And the reason for saying that is that many of these people who have written to me in these 100 letters that I've had from all over the province will have to have subsidized housing, will have to be in nursing homes. They're able to stay home now because they have a little money.
But the point that I'm interested in is that all you need is a guarantee so that the Teachers Investment and Housing Co-op can continue in business and distribute funds as is reasonable and proper while the deficit potential is guaranteed by the government.
Yes. We're not sure that the continuing of the co-op is our objective.
Best objective.
Because many of us feel that a merger would be a better proposition.
Dan, I'm afraid I must leave you there. I'm grateful you for giving me this story this morning. I think we've covered it quite well. I have one little bit of business I have to do after this, and I may have time for a call again back to Alma, so don't go away. After break. Two caravans are starting out from St. John's, Newfoundland tomorrow. One is sponsored by the Canadian Nature Federation with the Western Canada Wilderness Federation and Save South Moresby, you know, the David Suzuki people. The other one is sponsored by the concerned citizens of Moresby Island, the people from Sandspit who want multi-use of the Charlottes, and I don't have to give you all the background. And here on the phone from St. John's, Newfoundland is Pat Armstrong. Pat?
Hello, how you doing?
You're going to be dogging the heels of the environmentalists as they wind their way across Canada. How long is this going to take you to reach Queen Charlotte's?
Well, I guess we'll be back in Vancouver somewhere around the 14th or 15th of the month, and I hope I'm home by the 16th or 17th.
Whose idea was it that you should dog the heels of the wilderness people?
Well, I think it was a collective idea. I think that everybody, once we heard they were doing this, everybody in the community said, geez, we got to do something about this, because here they are, they're going to go out there and spread their propaganda right across Canada.
So you're going to go out all the meetings, try and hog appearances in the media, and generally kind of put some salt on the tail of all the big money wilderness people.
Well, that's exactly what we're up to, yeah. We want to get out there and just set the story straight and make sure that the working people of the Charlottes are heard from.
And who are you meeting with today?
Well, we've had a number of contacts today. I guess the most important one was with Richard Cashin, the president of the Newfoundland Fishermen, Food, and Allied Workers. And, you know, back in 76 and through the late 70s, they had an experience that's analogous to ours, where international environmentalists, big money environmentalists, put their fishermen and sealers out of work here.
Okay. Well, keep me in touch from time to time, and we'll see what happens. Brian Williams is going to bring down the Wilderness Committee report, hopefully on Friday.
You bet. Well, we'll be in touch with you, Jack, for sure, as we go along.
Yeah, okay. Much obliged, Pat. Had to bring people in today. We're getting that decision on Friday. Now, a couple of minutes yet, if you want to say anything else about the topic.
Yes, I certainly do.
Good. Other calls here? Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
Morning, Jack. Mrs. McGauley. Like Mrs. McGauley, I thought RRSP was secure. That so I saved from the time I started teaching to provide for my retirement, to be independent, not a burden to the government or anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
And now I find I can't touch those registered retirement savings.
How much have you got in them?
$40,000.
$40,000?
Yes.
You were telling me, Alma was telling me earlier, that if you just have deposits, you can get a small proportion of your deposit released by the
co-op.
By the co-op.
Well, under the
by the Coopers and Lybrand.
Coopers and Lybrand, yes.
Or whoever's doing it.
But. And one thing I would like to say quickly, not to cut off this woman, but to assure her and all my listeners that what we are doing, this campaign that we have undertaken, is endorsed by Coopers and Lybrand in some sense, because our lawyer corresponded with Coopers and Lybrand, and they took it seriously enough to refer it to their solicitor, Davis and Company. We have a letter on file back from Davis and Company to Coopers and Lybrand, copied and sent to us, which says, we encourage Mr. Dalton and his committee to pursue on behalf of depositors or member depositors, the government for this guarantee. So there is nothing about our plan that can endanger or jeopardize the sensitive negotiations we're told going on. We find it hard to accept that this situation of the co-op is so complicated that a fine interim receiver, as Coopers and Lybrand are reputed to be, have to take this long. The anxiety quotient for our people has just gone up fantastically over these 4 months till
we think Coopers and Lybrand are being a bit slow.
Well, they say it's a complex company, and of course I don't have any expertise to judge that on, but it's, I'm just saying it's caused a great hardship for our people that it's 4 months. And in the beginning, when the, some people did get their half of 1% and went to a bank, the bank indeed would not cash the check. Now that has since been rectified, but that also stood to increase the anxiety for people. It's so bad that I know now of, personally, of four people who are suffering nervous breakdowns over this.
Now, you're holding a meeting on March the 10th, that's next Monday night, that's at Charles Tupper Secondary School, of
that's
the Retired
right.
Teachers Association.
That's right, spearheaded by the retired teachers. And I'm making a plea to active teachers to support us as individuals, since the BCTF has thrown us to the wolves to somehow paddle our own canoe. We are asking active teachers as individuals to come to that meeting to hear our side of the story, to understand what's happening to their honorary members.
The BCTF has walked away from you altogether.
The BCTF has, under its legal advice, been...
No moral support?
No moral support, and they're I guess, afraid of lawsuit.
Could they in any way be held liable?
Yes, they certainly could, because the entity to which I paid my retirement savings was BCTF Retirement Savings Fund. That situation existed from whenever retirement savings started until 1980, when they then changed the name to Teachers Investment Housing Co-op. So I must say that the BCTF was very...
Well, it leaves you with a position of some hope, perhaps.
Well, what do you mean?
Are you pursuing that matter?
Not now. We accept that they aren't going to help us, and we've got to pursue the government. And so we're asking for an avalanche of letters to precede us to Victoria, because I believe in the power of the people.
Good. March the 21st is the proposed date with Bennett. March the 10th is the meeting in Tupper Secondary School on 7:30 at night. My thanks to Alma McGauley. You're an excellent spokesperson. I'll be back after the break.
Thank you very much.
Do we have all three unions here tomorrow?
Yes.
Good boy.
Excellent.
As long as it's running, that's fine.
There's a 30-second clip. You just do a voiceover. Just describe what you see. She's still...
What kind of a role have you got? What is it, 5 seconds in?
5 seconds in.
Yeah, fine then.
5 seconds into it, it's okay. How long is the close now altogether with that? That's 30.
It's only my eye.
You got... That's 30 seconds.
I've got a special guest who's going to drop in during tomorrow morning's program sometime, and that is Mila Mulroney. Now, I want to show you a scene at the South Terminal at Vancouver's International Airport this morning. For sure I want to show you. These are baggage handlers, members of Bob White's United Auto Workers, who signed an agreement with PWA in that lengthy strike. Last Friday, the Canadian Labour Relations Board ordered them back to work. But the machinists and the flight attendants haven't settled. So inside, the baggage handlers sit at the picket line with windows taped dark with paper as the strikers try to illumine their faces with a flashlight. Tomorrow we're going to have representatives of all three unions tomorrow to tell you about this complicated strike. And don't forget Mila Mulroney, if you please, with Webster at 9 a.m. precisely.
Expo 86. 60 days to go.